We have qualms, y'all.
Y'all, welcome back to the channel, or if you're new, welcome. Please subscribe. I'm not sure where to begin, but if you're new to the channel, we're usually here talking about Disney, menstruation, and film and television. Today, we're talking about Disney. Now, this is a very serious video because I have questions, I have concerns, and I have qualms. We just had the D23 Expo 2019. For those of you who don't know what D23 is, it is the Walt Disney Official Fan Club that has an expo at the Anaheim Convention Center every 2 years. Let me preface this by saying, I really wanted to go this year. I've never been to a D23. I just became a member earlier this year, but too much other stuff is going on with school and work and all the rest of it. So I'm hoping that that's for the best, because after having seen the live streams of the entire event, I'm glad that I didn't go. There is so much that I'm happy about, but we're here to talk about, well, we're here to talk about both, but Mama needs cocktail, per usual. I suggest you grab yours. I have notes. Please excuse the background noise. The windows have to stay open because Mama runs hot, and it's, we're having like a garden, somebody's doing work in the garden. I don't know what's happening. Let's start with what the FD23 is, right? So, again, official Disney fan club. Anyone can become a member, and anyone can attend the expo in Anaheim, held every 2 years. The 2017 expo was where we got like our first look at Galaxy's Edge. It was like huge announcements, like announcements of shit that like no one, that we saw coming, but we hadn't actually seen. 2019, y'all, I feel like, do we get punked? Like, we already knew all of this. So anyways, D23 is where they announce, like, everything, right? Like, all of the new IP that's coming out, you know, all any new acquisitions, new merchandise, you know, things relating to the cruise lines, new resorts, just anything and everything. Most importantly, though, is the panel on Sunday, which is the Disney Parks panel, where we get all of the major announcements about what's coming to the parks, both domestically and internationally, and that is what we are here for. Now, there was a big focus on Disneyland Paris, and Hong Kong Disneyland, because those are the three parks where we're getting the Avengers Campus. It's taken me a hot minute as a 37-year-old Disney kid to adjust to all of the acquisitions that Disney has made, essentially becoming a monopoly in the entertainment industry, excuse me, acquiring most recently Fox. Disney owns The Simpsons. Can we just talk about the fact that like The Simpsons meet and greet at D23 was like really awkward and nobody was waiting in line and it just didn't make sense? Anyways, that's gonna take an adjustment, especially for somebody that's on the eastern side of the Mason-Dixon line, because the Florida parks cannot actually do anything with the Marvel situation because Universal Studios still technically has rights to that here on the East Coast. That's why you're seeing the Avengers Campus coming to Disneyland. That's why you're seeing The Simpsons over there, because they can do what they want with that property. But it's taken me a while as a Disney kid to like adjust to the fact that Disney has Marvel in it now, which was always something you had to go to Islands of Adventure for. And of course, Star Wars. Now, am I mad about it? No, but it is an adjustment. There's part of me that's like, wait a second, like this is not, Disney is supposed to be Disney. and then now we have all of these other huge franchises, which I do love, obviously, but are they Disney? Are they Disney? Maybe, maybe not. It's a bigger question. Comment below what you think. I'm adjusting to it. I'm not mad about it. I love my Galaxy's Edge, and we're going to circle back to that because I know we all have feelings about Galaxy's Edge, but it's still an adjustment to see, especially here in California, to see in Disneyland, you know, Guardians of the Galaxy, where Tower of Terror used to be, even though it's a great ride. To see those characters walk around is just, for a second it takes me anyways, it takes me out of being at Disney, and then I'm like, okay, this is still awesome. So it's an adjustment, but at the end of the day, Walt's vision was such that Disneyland and Disney and Epcot would never be done, right? Like, that's the magic of it, that it's ever evolving. Is it evolving into something, or is it revolutionizing? Is it becoming something other than? I don't know. Again, these are big questions. These are philosophical questions. This is why I'm a philosophy major. Now then, let's get down to brass tacks here. Otherwise, I'm going to ramble because, you know what? The whole thing's got me a little, like, twisted up because I'm 37 years old. I look at YouTubers. This is a sidebar. It's a rant. Grab a drink. You know, I watch all of these YouTubers who I know and love. You know, your Tim Trackers, your Oybees, your Life Disney and Beyonds, your Adam the Woo, your Michael Kays, your Spokesmanes. You know, I'm watching all of these people who, for somebody who left Orlando 9 years ago to move to California and do something a little bit different, have kind of been my lifeline to my home parks and to something that I can't experience anytime I want. Like, I used to just be able to, like, walk into the park with my pass. You know, I now have a pass to both and can walk into Disneyland anytime. But living in the Bay Area, they're both still more than a drive, you know, it's not even a drive away. So I watch these YouTubers, most of whom are much younger than I am, and I think to myself, oh my god, if I had been YouTubing about Disney like 10 years ago, I'd be a bazillionaire. I'd be the PewDiePie of Disney. That's neither here nor there, but I think it's important to mention that, like, even, like, the newer generation, the younger generation, who are hardcore Disney kids, are still so appreciative and aware of how important the nostalgia is with Disney World, specifically with Disney World, and specifically with Epcot. And Epcot being kind of an anomaly as far as theme parks go, there's nothing like it anywhere else in the world as far as a theme or amusement park is concerned. And I just think it's really amazing that, you know, the people that I mentioned, like Spokesman, Michael Kay, you know, I think Tim and Jen are roughly my age, but, like, a lot of these people are like 10 or more years younger than me, and they have World of Micah, you know, like, they have such an appreciation for the old school Disney shit, and I think that that speaks to why this D23 was just really, really confusing. And anyways, I honestly, I have notes, like, I literally have an outline, and I don't even know where to begin. Let's talk about, this is about Epcot, y'all. You know I don't like to edit my videos, so this is going to be a long one. We got our Avengers Campus, we got our, you know, things that are coming to Disneyland Paris, and I think it was Shanghai Disneyland, that they're getting the Frozen Land. Great, congratulations, blessings to you. Let's talk about Disney World, specifically Epcot. Let's talk about what Mama likes. Mama likes the new logo, which is actually the old logo. We got the Epcot blue sky kind of artwork in D23 2017, so we knew that an Epcot overhaul was coming, and they gave us, you know, that blue sky situation, and it looked very pretty. It was like, okay, cool. Interventions West is gone. Okay, cool things, green, lush. We get it. All right. When is this happening? Is it happening in time for Walt Disney World's 51st anniversary? Like, what's the timeline? Like, all of these questions, right? We thought we were gonna get answers this weekend. Nay. Nay, we did not. I'm not sure what this bullshit is, but it's too short to go on my ponytail, y'all. Okay, whatever. Anyways, the new logo, which is a throwback to the old logo. Here we go. You got it, Mel. So when we got that blue sky artwork, or kind of mock-up back in 2017 at the D23, we knew that there was going to be a little bit of, well, a lot of modernization to what is the quote-unquote spine of Epcot, what connects Future World to World Showcase. Over the past 2 years, we've gotten more updates through the Disney Parks blog that showed that the entry to the entryway to Epcot was going to basically be beautified. They were going to take the hideous League of Legacy monoliths out and move them to the front, like into the parking lot area. And, you know, we're going to get like planters and topiaries and green spaces. I'm all for that. On top of that, they're bringing back the original Epcot logo. You can see it on the flags in the new artwork. And what Mama is very happy about is that they're bringing back the spires, the glass spires to the fountain that is currently situated in front of Spaceship Earth. Very happy about these things. One of the things that they did announce at D23 that got a huge crowd reaction, and well deserved, is that Epcot is getting a statue of Walt, and it looks beautiful. It's like a full life-size statue of Walt sitting down on top of a series of steps looking out into Future World. I think that's amazing. I think we need that. Walt Disney World and Disneyland and DCA all have partner statues in some form or fashion. I think it's important, with Epcot being so connected to Walt, that there is something to represent his presence in that park. That's why the D23 announcements about the Epcot overhaul are a little bittersweet and a little bit confusing, because we know Disney World and Disneyland are never supposed to be finished. He said it himself. What we also know is that Epcot is built, the current Epcot park that we know is the result of several iterations of an original vision Walt had. The original being Progress City, which was to be an actual city designed in the, you know, designed as a wheel where you have the hub in the center, where you have all of the goings on, and then you have the spokes coming off of it with, you know, the actual residential areas with a transportation center, a method of transportation that would bring you to the center. Progress City didn't actually obviously come to fruition. You can see a model of Progress City on the People Mover when you're in Walt Disney World and at the Walt Disney Family Museum here at the Presidio in the Bay Area. From there, we got a theme park called Epcot Center, which Epcot, if you don't know, stands for the Energy Prototype Community of Tomorrow. Sorry, I'm looking over here because there's construction and people are knocking on my door. That's the neighbor's door. Okay, sorry. So we got Epcot Center. Epcot Center was what opened in 1982, the year of my birth. And that is the theme park that started the whole thing off. It was Future World and World Showcase. The idea of Epcot and Progress City were built on Walt's visit to the World's Fair, and this idea of progress, innovation, and technology and culture that brings us into the future. The innovative spirit of human nature that brings us ever forward. So Future World, for us diehard Epcot people, is very important, especially given the fact that we've lost 2.5 of the greatest theme park rides in all of human history. World of Motion, Horizons, and the bastardization of Journey into Imagination, which we can't even get into or we're going to get really upset. So, what's left of Future World is Test Track, which can suck a bag of dicks as far as I'm concerned. Give me World of Motion back any day of the week. But we have Test Track, okay, fine. Mission Space as a replacement to Horizons, to me, hurts me on a level I can't really get into right now. But Mission Space as a ride is brilliant. Some of the most innovative technology that we've seen at any theme parks. And of course, we're getting the accompanying Space Restaurant, Space 220, which I'm ambivalent about. I really don't care. The only thing that excites me about Space 220, the restaurant, is that they're going to have a space elevator, which is very reminiscent of something we lost at the Living Seas, which is now the Seas with Nemo. Because God forbid we have anything that's not tied to an IP. There used to be at the Living Seas the hydrolators. So when you would get off the ride and you'd go down into the aquarium, which, fun fact, if you didn't know, the Living Seas was once the country's, I believe even the world's, largest aquarium. It's now the second largest. But you would go into a hydrolator, an elevator that made it look and feel like you were going under the sea. Without CGI, it was all practical effects. So the idea that the Space Restaurant is going to have a similar situation, and we're probably going to get a similar situation with the Halcyon and the Star Cruiser, Star Wars Resort and all that, very cool. But I say all of that to say, you know, Future World basically is Mission Space, Test Track, and we've also lost Wonders of Life and Universe of Energy, Ellen's Energy Adventure. I have gotten right with the Lord on Guardians replacing Ellen's Energy Adventure or Universe of Energy for one reason and one reason only. Epcot has no rides. So I think that's the only thing that I can get right with is like we have like another ride at Epcot. That's fun. Because right now, I mean, Test Track is fun, but like the theming of Test Track doesn't speak to me. Mission Space is fun, but I mean, you can only ride Mission Space so many times before you have an acid flashback or just throw up. That's what Future World is. We've lost Interventions. We haven't had Interventions in the better part of a decade. We know Interventions West is going away to make room for the nature, what is it called, World of Nature, the new neighborhoods, because we don't have Future World anymore. We have neighborhoods. We have World, what is it? Where are my notes? No notes? Oh. We have World Discovery, we have World Nature, and World Celebration. So World Discovery is basically like what remains of Future World. Your Guardians, Cosmic Rewind, cool, we're getting a reverse launch. Coaster, awesome, love it. We're getting, so World Discovery is your Mission Space, your Test Tracks, and your Guardians of the Galaxy bullshit. World Nature is going to be the Seas and the Land, which thank God aren't leaving, and the new Moana water walkthrough bullshit. Sure, fine, fantastic. I'm here for that. What else? Let's get into... Okay. This may actually be the first video I edit because it's going to be a long one. World Showcase, of course, is staying, but the loss of Future World is still like a blow. And we know that Epcot is shifting from this notion of tomorrow and the future to like just this general idea of progress, I guess. They use the word progress more times than I can count. And it's like progress towards what? Like, isn't that the future? Like, y'all can help me out. I don't know. So we still have Spaceship Earth. We know she's not going anywhere. Thank effing God. She has been long rumored to be getting a renovation. They did confirm that. They are going to keep some classic scenes, probably up until the Industrial Revolution. However, they're going to incorporate a storytelling light that's going to kind of drive the narrative, and they're going to revive some of the older scenes with some new tech, which I'm here for that. That's fine. What happens after the Industrial Revolution? I don't know what that's going to look like. The new narrative is, again, with Spaceship Earth, not about technology and innovation. It's about storytelling now, which I'm actually here for, because they are correct in saying that the one thing that connects all of us is storytelling. So I'm here for this. I've already lost my Tomorrow's Child. I lost my Walter Cronkite. I lost my Jeremy Irons. You know, we have the Dame Judi Dench with us right now. That's fantastic. I'm very curious to see who the new narrator is going to be. But I'm just worried, again, that they're going to replace too much. They're going to get rid of too much nostalgia with such a iconic... It's an icon. It's so simple. Practical animatronic effects. 1982 technology. I mean... I'm worried. I'm excited, but I'm worried, and this is what freaks me out about this whole thing. Alright. A couple more things I'm okay with before we get into what I'm really, really, really scared of. I'm really here for the beautification, World Celebration, like Spine at Epcot. I'm really excited about what they've designed, the greenery, the new fountain, the cool, like, tree, whatever. The Moana bullshit. I'm okay. The really exciting thing is obviously the kind of three-level Highline Festival Center multi-purpose building, right? So we know we have like an open plaza on the bottom, fantastic. Then we have like the second floor, which is enclosed. There's obviously some sort of like broadcast situation in there. They're probably gonna have the Festival Center food demonstrations in there, and then of course the third level being the kind of Highline moment, where it's like an exposed garden and it's gonna have 360 views of Epcot and World Showcase specifically. I think that's amazing, super excited. Disney has nothing like this anywhere, and I'm here for that, so I'm super stoked for that. One of the things that they did not talk about excuse me, as far as the renovation of Future World is concerned, because we know we're losing Interventions West to make room for this World Nature neighborhood. Interventions East is staying with renovations. You know, rest in peace, Electric Umbrella. Mouse Gear is getting a renovation. Fine. Why did they not talk about Journey into Imagination? Because we know it was not only in the concept art, and there is clearly some like renovations being done to the exterior. It looks beautiful. It's in the abstract model. They did not bring up Journey into Imagination or the Imagination Pavilion. The Imagineer who's in charge of the Epcot overhaul even mentioned Figment. Excuse me, but they didn't mention the pavilion at all. This is a critical pavilion for Epcot, especially for people that are diehard Epcot fans and Disney kids. We already know, again, when I said they got rid of 2.5 of the greatest rides, the half being Journey into the Imagination, because the ride's still there, but they basically took a big shit on it, and we've been living with that shit for a while. And on top of that, they got rid of Captain EO, and I don't give a flying who's he, what's it, what your opinions on Michael Jackson is. Captain EO is one of the greatest short films ever, and it should freaking be in Epcot. It upsets me so. No notes. No notes on Journey into Imagination. No notes. What else? Moana, Guardians. Okay, so in the ad, they didn't even mention anything about World Showcase, with the exception of the UK Pavilion, which I'm going to get to. But in the abstract model, you see a lot of Coco stuff with the Mexico Pavilion, which again, I was nervous about another IP coming to one of the pavilions, especially after Frozen replaced Maelstrom, which I will make an entire video docu-series on how fucking wrong that shit is. But Coco actually, as an intellectual property, is about Mexico and Mexican culture, and it therefore has a viable place and a relevant place within the Mexico Pavilion. Whereas Frozen takes place in Arendelle, which is a watered-down amalgamation of all of Scandinavia and is completely fictional, and they basically said fuck you to the Norwegian people. Coco coming to Mexico, I'm here for. France. Again, they're not giving us, there's no new news. We know Ratatouille's coming, we know France is expanding. Skyliner, 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 we're getting a Crate Beret, fantastic, whatever. The big World Showcase announcement was that we're getting a Mary Poppins expansion, a UK Pavilion expansion, with Cherry Tree Lane coming to the UK Pavilion. I'm here for that. I think the UK has a lot of underutilized real estate. The only other thing that they could really do is Alice in Wonderland, but that doesn't really work with Epcot. So Mary Poppins coming to the UK I think is great. But again, they didn't go into any effing detail. Like, they didn't, they kind of alluded to the fact that there might be a ride, but like, they didn't go into any detail. A lot of people, I think, have said that, like, they did say that there's going to be a dark ride, but they didn't talk about it. There was no timeline, nothing. People have been speculating that we were going to get, like, some Mary Poppins-themed merry-go-round, so this is good news, right? We're actually getting an expansion to the pavilion. It does tie into an IP, but a classic one, one that is fitting, that sits well within the context of Epcot. I'm here for this, and another ride in World Showcase I'm here for it. So that was good news, and then of course Dick Van Dyke came out, and that was amazing. What else do we have here? Fireworks. So we know that Illuminations is ending on September 30th. I will be there for the finale. It's going to be very bittersweet, but it is time for a change. We're going to get Epcot Forever for a year, and then the new permanent show, Harmonious. Here for that, fantastic, all good. We were expecting for like over a year now that they were going to announce a Brazil pavilion at World Showcase. Like, permits have been filed, talks with the Brazilian government have been had. Why was there no new pavilion? And with all of those beautiful posters that were put out on display at the Epcot Parks Pavilion inside of the Expo, you know, they had the old attractions, you know, defunct attractions, new attractions, and upcoming attractions, and then they had like the two that were covered up saying will be revealed Sunday. Like, everyone was like, okay, we're getting Brazil and maybe something special. Well, the something special was Mary Poppins. Okay, fine, fantastic, here for Poppins. We didn't get Brazil. They just unveiled a poster for the already announced three-level festival building. Why aren't we getting a new country? We know we have the real estate for it. We know we have the real estate for at least three countries. The only thing that I can glean from what I've read and from what I've heard and from what I've watched is that maybe we have not worked out the details with the Brazilian government. Maybe we don't have a sponsor locked in. It probably is still coming, maybe just on a delay. But like, that's a huge effing letdown. Like, to know that your audience knows that Brazil has been coming down the pike for like the better part of 5 years, and to not announce a new pavilion. It's been 37 years. We need some new countries in there. I'm not even gonna tell you which one you can replace. What else? What else am I upset about? No more Future World. No talk of Journey into Imagination. No new country. Here's what really frosts my cookies. There was really no timelines announced on any of this. Like, why aren't we talking about a rough timeline for Mary Poppins. Why? I mean, okay, so they announced Ratatouille, they announced Space Restaurant. We didn't get a hard and fast announcement on Guardians. I think we got like a rough whatever. We know when the fireworks are coming, but there was no announcement on Poppins. There was no announcement as far as the Innoventions East renovation is concerned. Like, when is Mouse Gear getting replaced? What's replacing the electric umbrella? Because they showed concept art for it, but no dates. No notes, no dates. What's happening to Club Cool? Are we replacing it? Are we moving it? People need their Beverly. Everyone needs a tight palate cleanse. When is the statue coming? When does Spaceship Earth begin to shut down for renovations? How long is that going to take? How many years do I have to not ride Spaceship Earth? When is the spire coming to the fountain? When is the new entryway going to be complete? When will Mexico turn into Coco? What's happening with Journey to Imagination? And when the fuck is the beautification going to be done? When is the overhaul going to be done? It's clearly not going to be done in time for 51. So, like, what's our timeline? Is it 2 years? Is it 3 years? Is it 4 years? People are going to... Mickey views... He made an excellent point when he said that normally in the past, and possibly a mistake on the company's part, back in 2017 when they announced Galaxy's Edge, this entire new land, they announced it so far in advance that people were postponing their trips because they were like, well, we'll just wait until. And I think Mickey Views made a good point in saying that they're doing the opposite now because they don't want that to happen again. They're doing, and he thinks it's short-sighted, I agree, but they're doing the opposite because they don't want guests, they don't want to lose that guest revenue, and they don't want to postpone guests coming to the parks because they want to wait for X, Y, and Z. So, I get it, but also I agree with Mickey Views that it is short-sighted, and it's a disappointment to your pass holders, to your families that come on a regular basis, especially when you've just raised the price point on all passes by 20% and you're pricing a lot of people out. You didn't give us everyone wants a fifth gate, but we were all pretty like confident that like that was not going to get announced. It's too soon for a fifth gate. But, like, there was nothing announced that we didn't already know was happening. We got more information on shit we already knew about. Excuse me, which is fantastic. Nothing new. Nothing new. What was new? What was new that we didn't know about? Mary Poppins. I mean, and even that was speculated. What? Nothing. The Walt Disney statue? Here for it. Not worthy of like a Galaxy's Edge level announcement. And I just feel like for people who grew up going to the parks, whether it be Disneyland, Disney World, or one of the international parks, this is a huge letdown for your biggest diehard fans, your biggest spenders. And on top of that, having already priced people out of being able to visit, who are your diehards, it's a little upsetting, it's a little unnerving. Mickey Views, Brandon Crater also made a good point in saying that like when some of these executives retire and we get in the new guard, we will be able to, you know, reap the rewards of some of these improvements to the park that are much needed. You know, again, the Epcot overhaul is much needed, but we'll maybe move away from such heavily tied in relationships to IP and get back to Epcot being about future and about culture. Because there seems to be a little bit of a disconnect there. But these are growing pains, so again, overall, I'm really happy. But I do have my qualms I do have my qualms. I'm most concerned about Dreamfinder and Figment because we need to care for them. We need to make sure that the spaceship is salvaged from Mount's gear and doesn't go in the garbage like the polar bear from Maelstrom, who was sitting in the back lot, literally rotting along with the Stitch animatronic. Don't get me started. I think that's it, guys. I think I've vented. Comment below. Let me know what your thoughts are. If you have any insights. I'm sweating. Look at that. I'm worked up. Let me know what you think. I'd love to have a dialogue with people that actually give a shit about this stuff. It's very important to me to see my home park, but specifically Epcot, which again, as I said at the beginning of this video, is such an anomaly and such a gem and such a... It's really something that needs to be... It needs a caretaker, it needs a steward, it really needs someone at the top, at the executive level, that understands it to really usher it in to the next iteration of what it should be without forgetting what it's built on. So anyways, I will leave you with that. Please come at me and comment below. I'm gonna drink this one off. Cheers, you guys. Love you. Also, subscribe.